to me the best of both
worlds.
And it's hard. It's really hard to pull it off because it can't be dominantly history, and it can't be dominantly CIA. The Library Journal just gave it one of the top five thrillers of the year award. And what their comment was, it was the best review I could have ever hoped for, and that it was the best of both worlds.
Yeah.
The best of both history and of espionage. I like that a lot. I had worked hard for that.
Yeah. Well, actually, when you get to Catapult, which I feel is a Gail Lynn's creation.
It is. Catapult. But it's based on other black units. It's a black unit, which means it's even its money is off the books. It's funded through CIA black funds that there's no accounting for.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a headquarters in the Washington, D.C. area, and a small cadre of operatives who work around the world. And they're, one of their biggest charges is to stop actions before they become before they can become full flower and hurt us. So mm-hmm. they intervene, and this book is actually about intervening in terrorist financing and how it would affect the war in Afghanistan.
But how about the fact that there are people in these catapults in black whose finances are coming because they're following orders from some of these places?
Yes, and that does happen. The CIA takes an awful lot of hits, and a lot of times they really deserve it, but they also do some very good things. As you probably have read about, it's now being revealed that Israel and the United States cooperated in creating the worm that took down the Iran nuclear reactors.
Now, but that's a long time ago.
No, this just...
Recently?
Yes. And so my point of talking about that is that with Catapult, some of the stuff it does is really important work.
Yeah.
And I have no idea why I came up with that name. It's just a strange name.
Yeah, well, it's a good... Did you write this while you were living in Maine?
No, I wrote that in Santa Barbara, and I finished it in Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm living in Maine now, beginning in the spring.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Do you miss San... I mean, because they're two diverse worlds.
And very similar, too, because Portland, Maine, and Santa Barbara are both about 80,000. They're right on the water. They both have commercial fishing fleets. Very different architecture and very different weather. But it's quite beautiful there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I'm selling my house, which is very interesting. I'm looking at all this stuff I've accumulated. Where did it all come from? Now I have to get rid of it.
Maybe you have a library of gold there.
My office is a research library. Mm-hmm. It has become, it's just evolved because I do so much research.
Yeah. But you bring something else out that I didn't know, that the government had a thing to erase part of islands.
Oh,
on
yes,
the map.
Yes, yes. There's and you stop and you think about it. I was Googling north of Washington, D.C. recently because of the new book I'm working on, and part of the landscape was hazy because that's off limits. There is there's bases there and flyovers that we don't want other people to see, so we make it so hazy you can't read it. So they have, the government has the capability of literally erasing terrain.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
So in our friend's Library of Gold, they find the island where it is. But now they're moving it. They moved it to outside of Switzerland.
Yes, in Switzerland, in the Alps. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So the Library of Gold still, one of the reasons I wrote this book is I wanted to find the Library of Gold. I'm sorry, it is such a delicious idea. And those of us who read books, read them because we love them.
Yeah.
So this was my chance to go and explore the Library of Gold. So of course, when I wrote the book, I knew it was going to end in the Library of Gold because I thought readers would want to find it too and know what it was like.
And you didn't want it blown up.
Well, I couldn't blow it up.
Yeah.
You're right, soft spot. And so the directors, when they know that they're going to be going, that it's very possible that their library is being discovered, they put in process their backup plan to move it, and it's going to the Alps. Now, where it's going to be in the next book, because this is the first book of a series, and I'm already finding that I'm referring to the Library Gold in the next book, so I don't know. I may have to find it again.
Oh, all right.
In a future book.
Yeah, and the other part of it is that you have very evil people like Preston.
Yes, Douglas Preston. And
and how he got to be in your book.
And how he got to be in the book. But he also loves books a lot. He's a killer who loves books. That was a nice combination, I thought, in my mind. Douglas Preston is a wonderful writer, New York Times bestseller, award winner, and a great guy. Yeah. And he tells the story that he paid $100 for 100 tickets to win a character name in my next book. And he won. Of course, you could spend $100 on tickets. You know you're going to win. And so he grabbed me and he said, I want to be the villain.
Well, he got his wish.
He got his wish.
What about the carnivora?
The carnivore.
Carnivore. Excuse me.
Listen, it confuses there. It's the carnivore. He comes back because over the years, he's appeared in two other earlier of my books. And I've had so many readers ask me to bring him back that I talked to my editor, who thought it was a great idea, and so he does appear, and I believe we see him either in Abu Dhabi and eventually in Istanbul and then in Athens, so he's getting around. We actually in this book get to see where he lives now.
And the fact he's related to that young boy
Bash Badawi.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, I loved Bash. Bash with his skateboard. He looks like a kid, and he's this top flight CIA agent. The whole thing about being a CIA officer is people who really stand out don't make very good undercover operatives. But if you can blend one way or another, then you have a chance of really making a contribution. So Bash blends as a nice young man.
Someone told me that some of the really deepest secrets and deals that are made have been made in London in the park because nobody knows which seat you're going to sit on.
I think that's true, but it also happens happens to be true in Washington. I'm trying to think of the park that's right outside the White House, but that is a major spot for undercover people to meet assets, for instance, or agents.
Have any of your books been made into films?
Two of them are optioned at this point. And both of the options are running out in the next couple of months, so I have no idea what's going to happen. One of the Last Spy Master, which is the previous one to this, is in development, so we'll see. The idea of translating from one art form to another is endlessly intriguing. You know, take a poem and turn it into a vase. Take a book, turn it into a movie. So, yes, I would love to see that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they really is one. It's sort of, you know, Mona Lisa here.
Yes.
Yeah.
True.
Shirley, and the cover is great because it's Rome at night.
It is Rome at night. And those are the stairs to... Now I've forgotten where it is, but it's a Rome scene that, of course, does not appear in the book. But that's the way it always is.
Yeah. Well, but the information you've put in about Rome is really startling, because as much as you know Rome, you don't know some of the factors that are there.
Yes, that's true. And I had so much more I wanted to put in the book about Rome. But what a remarkable city. And I think one of the best things about it now is the way it has cleaned itself up and made accessible to the public its history.
Yeah.
And it's safer and cleaner and more beautiful than ever.
Well, I wish you a good trip there.
Thank you.
Istanbul, too, because Istanbul is just full of spies. I mean, no matter where you go, you feel eyes are on you.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't understand why would anybody change a wonderful name like Constantinople to Istanbul? I mean, Constantinople, and it's like Iraq should be still Mesopotamia.
Yeah.
These wonderful old names.
Have you been to Egypt?
No, and I would like to see that. Now, see, that's a name that hasn't changed.
Yeah, Cairo is Cairo. Mm-hmm. I thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Will you autograph my book, Gail? And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com. And you can link into YouTube. You can link into Claremont Graduate University that has digitized over 600 shows. One of the books I've really liked recently is P.G. Sturgis's Shortcut Man. It's written really like L.A. Noir. Short scenes, very exciting. And a shortcut man is the sort who, well, he's given the job of evicting people. And they're usually lowlife who deserve to be. He will go in and he knows in 24 minutes how to get them out in 24 hours. Very exciting book, not to mention the murder part of it. He also is the son of the great film writer-director Preston Sturges. And have you been to your library lately? Support your local library. How's the library up in Portland?
It's beautiful. It's a very interesting, well-educated state. I'm enjoying it a lot. A lot of readers up there.
Yeah. Oh, great. And do you use the library up there?
Not as much as I used to, but the access is amazing. It's a bit of a drive because we're out in the country.
But everything's on the computer now.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. But there's still nothing like holding that book in your hand.
I know. And the hardcover.
Yeah. So support your library, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Gail.
My pleasure.